What's going on, everybody? FutureRail Productions here. It is Tuesday, May 7th, and this is episode 5 of FutureRail Travels. Hope you enjoy. So I'm all packed up over there. Don't know if you guys can see that right there. Big suitcase right over there ish. So I'm all packed up. Today we'll be heading out to Sydney, Nebraska with stops along the way at Omaha, Kearney, I think you have to pronounce it, and then Lexington. Those are important stops along the way with history of the Union Pacifc. And then the day after tomorrow we'll be stopping in Cheyenne. We'll be stopping at Sherman Hill. The original Sherman Hill where the Ames Monument is, and then from there we're gonna just go straight on into Ogden and Tremont, and then the day after tomorrow is the big boy, so I'm looking forward to that, so that's gonna be a lot of fun. And then Friday is May 10th, which is the 150th anniversary of the Transcontinental Railroad's completion. Of course, you all know this from watching this, but I'm pretty excited, so well, I'll see you guys when we're on the road. Bye.
Sometimes you bend, sometimes you stand, sometimes you turn your back to the wind. There's a world outside every darkened door, where blues won't haunt you anymore. Where the brave are free and lovers soar, come ride with me to the distant shore. We won't hesitate to break down the garden gate. There's not much time left today.
We're currently in front of Union Pacifc number 423. This is the big boy steam locomotive. You guys will be seeing 4014 in a couple minutes. But here in Omaha, not far from us right now, on July 10th, 1865, the Union Pacifc laid rails for the first time ever. Hey guys, FutureRail here. We're currently in Kearney, Nebraska,
The railroad got here in August of 1866, and the cool part about it is we are halfway between the East Coast and the West Coast. So we're outside of Lexington, Nebraska. It was also known as Plum Creek at one time. Here we are, we're at the spot where there was a train wreck due to a band of Southern Cheyenne Indians. And there was a guy who survived, and he was a telegrapher. His name was William Thompson. Anyways, he was scalped, and he didn't die from the scalping. So this is actually the spot where it occurred. And, you know, he kept his scalp. He tried to have it reattached, apparently. And then, it never was reattached. And then he donated to the guy who tried to reattach it for him. And then I guess it was put on public display at the Omaha Public Library, where it's in a dark room now, apparently. I'm not really sure of the story behind it, but this is the spot. Kind of feels weird, to be honest. Hey everybody, FutureRail Productions here again. We're currently at the Cody Park Railroad Museum in North Platte, Nebraska, in front of number 3977 here. The railroad reached here in December of 1866, and North Platte is also the location of the world's largest rail yard, Bailey Yard.
Good morning, everybody. It's FutureRail Productions here again. We just got to Sydney, late last night, and I was just too tired to film anything. But today, we're going to be driving from Sydney to Tremont in Utah, where we're going to spend the night. But first, we're going to stop in Cheyenne and hopefully Ames Monument, depending on the road conditions. So hopefully they're good. So I'll see you guys in a little bit.
Hey guys, FutureRail here. We're currently outside Julesburg, Colorado. The railroad got here in June of 1867, but this town is known for something a little more darker than the railroad. The Sand Creek Massacre occurred in 1864, and then in retaliations by Arapaho, Sioux, and Cheyenne occurred the next January and February of 1865. On the second raid done by the Indians, the entire town of Julesburg was burnt to the ground. Here we are in Cheyenne, Wyoming. The railroad reached here in 1867. In 1890, Wyoming became a state and Cheyenne its capital. And today, Cheyenne holds the Union Pacifc steam locomotive program. Here we are at the ghost town of Sherman, Wyoming, presumably named after William Tecumseh Sherman. This part of the railroad was the highest point along the entire transcontinental line. At one time, this place boasted a roundhouse with 5 stalls, a turntable, 2 section houses, and a windmill with a water tank. Trains here were inspected before beginning the long descent from the Sherman Pass summit, either east toward Cheyenne or west across the 130-foot Dale Creek Bridge to the Laramie Valley. The trusses for the original wooden bridge located west of Sherman were prefabricated in Chicago and shipped to the site. The bridge was the highest railroad bridge in the world at the time of its completion in 1868. Several hundred people lived in Sherman, hunkered down upon a rocky, barren landscape, interrupted only by a general store, post office, schoolhouse, 2 hotels, the Sherman House and the Summit House, and 2 saloons. Sadly for the town of Sherman, its death came in 1918. The railroad company closed the station house and relocated the tracks about 3 miles south. Residents soon abandoned Sherman, leaving behind a small cemetery that is still present today. Today, all that remains of Sherman, Wyoming is the roundhouse pit with some of the bricks still inside the dirt, and the Ames Monument. No foundations and no buildings remain. Hey guys, we're currently at the Evanston Roundhouse in Evanston, Wyoming. Evanston, Wyoming was a locomotive service and crew division point between Green River and Ogden, and was named after James A. Evan, who was the surveyor who marked the eastern half of the railroad's route through Wyoming. A 20-stall stone roundhouse was built in the 1870s, and a replacement built in 1912, which is this one right here, and it's being restored. Part of the roundhouse is used as a venue for special events, so this is a pretty cool location. I'm really enjoying this trip so far, and get this, even the turntable still works, so I'm hoping someday they'll get it completely restored. And there's rumors that they're actually bringing a steam engine in, so that's gonna be pretty cool. Hope to come back someday.
Hey guys, FutureRail Productions here again. We made it to Tremonton. Sorry I didn't update last night. We're pretty tired, so we're on our way down to Ogden to go see the big boy. See you guys in a little bit.
Hey guys, we're in downtown Ogden right now. The railroad got here in March of 1869, and then in December of 1869, the railroad junction for Promontory was moved here to Ogden, and then Promontory became a helper station mostly for the Central Pacific. So here, almost 150 years ago, it was just completely blown up. I mean, it's still a huge, huge town today. I mean, I'm just loving the history here. I will see you guys in a little bit with the Union Pacific Big Boy number 4014.
So right over there, guys, that's Union Pacific 844. 4014 should be coming on any minute, hopefully. So this is gonna be awesome.
Scott Moore, Union Pacific CAO and Senior Vice President of Corporate Relations. And today we are surrounded by the beauty of your mountains and the mammoth machines brought by Union Pacific, the 4014 and the 844. If you're a train fan, if you're a history buff, if you're a nature lover, today is a great day and we are glad that you're here. I know some of you have traveled literally from across the globe to be here today, and we are glad you're here. Also, I want to say thank you for the city of Ogden. Although a little breezy, almost a perfect Chamber of Commerce day, I know the mayor's been all morning, and we thank you for your hospitality. We are going to start today's program with a national anthem and presentation of our colors. We have Ogden's own Katie Barton here, who is going to sing the national anthem in a moment, before our hometown here in Ogden. But with her will be Union Pacific Honor Guard. Last year, the Union Pacific Honor Guard was selected to stand guard at the Memorial Wreath Dedication Ceremony in D.C. And last December, they performed at the ceremony for George Herbert Walker Bush's funeral train ceremony when Union Pacific transported an American hero to his final resting place. For those of you that are not standing, would you please rise for the presentation of the colors, followed by our national anthem.
Next to 844. You see it?
Say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous streaming. And the rockets ripping, the bombs bursting in the air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say, does that star sprinkle banner yet wearing o'er the land of the free and the home of the
Thank you, Katie, and thank you, Union Pacifc Honor Guard. If you can be seated, you may be seated. And now I'd like to welcome Union Pacific's Chairman, President, and CEO, Lance Fritz, to the stage. He is the man who gave the green light to bring Locomotive 4014 back to life. Lance, the microphone is yours.
Thank you very much, Scott, and thank you, City of Ogden. Thank you, Mayor Caldwell, and the thousand volunteers that are making the day possible here in Ogden. Or should I call this Steamtown USA? Yeah. Amen. So let's get started. Let's get into what we're here for today. I want to introduce the celebrities of this morning. On my left, Union Pacific number 844, the living legend, brought to Union Pacific in 1944, topping out at a speed 110 miles an hour. Oh, come on, we can do better than that for the far down the track on my right, the latest steam locomotive to join the Union Pacific family, the big boy, Union Pacific 4014. All 1.2 million pounds, 7,000 horsepower of steel and fire waiting down the track. So let's get started on why we're here today.
Union Pacific Lance Fritz calling Union Pacific Big Boy number 4014. Over.
Union Pacific 4014 responding to Chairman Lance Fritz. Come in, over.
I'm in position in front of your locomotive. We're ready for you to make a move. Are you ready? Over.
Seat UP 4014 is ready to proceed. Chairman Fritz, over.
Pacific 4014, take them ahead. Over.
Understood. Here we come. Union Pacific coming ahead.
Listen up,
here we
my
come,
friends.
Sir.
Won't you engineer? Think about the biggest steam engine in the world. All 600 tons of iron, love, and fun. Rolls down the tracks like a huge Leviathan. Big boy, big. Hear the power and the rumble of the big, big boy. Big boy, big boy. Oh, throttle up the oldest tough, big, big boy.
Okay, one last thing. You know, we're going to close this event today the same way we closed that epic day 150 years ago tomorrow. Then, they used a state-of-the-art communication technique in the telegraph, as they telegraphed to the country the completion. At 2:27 p.m. that day, a telegraph from Promontory, almost ready, hats off, prayer is being offered. Chicago replies, we understand, all is ready in the east. At 2:47, the telegraph from Promontory was the simple word done. So please join me in using today's modern state-of-the-art communication and share your location that you're here today by using whatever social media channel you use and taking this moment, hashtag done.
Hey guys, FutureRail Productions here. Sorry about that jet noise. Air Force Base nearby, I guess. Just finished up getting all my merch. The big boy, you know, is big. We're going to be doing some interviews here soon, and then we're going to be heading back to the hotel. So I'll see you guys later. Bye.
So this is
Reese. I'm right in front of these two big edges right there. 844 is right there, 4014 is right there.
What are you looking forward to for the event so far?
What I'm looking forward to is, you know, I kind of actually don't know a little bit. You know, the crowds, whatever I'm looking for, I'm pretty much looking at how I love these locomotives. All the videos I've seen so far and their whistles in real life, the whistle blowing, and this is what I was looking for all along, dying to see these engines.
And what is your favorite part about the event so far? Like, what, other than 4014, what have you enjoyed at this moment?
What I enjoyed is the Union Pacifc 844 whistle blow. And I gotta tell you, both of them are pretty much really loud. They're both really loud. They're both beautiful too. And I really like the size of 844, how good the locomotive was.
Well, thank you for your time, Bree. FutureRail Productions here again. We're back and we're just finished the day. So this is the end of part one, FutureRail Travels episode 5. I'll see you guys tomorrow for Promontory Summit. So that's gonna be fun. I'll see you guys later. Bye.
But before long, steam-powered trains became the fastest and most popular form of transportation, carrying people and freight for a growing nation. But settlers couldn't travel west by train because the only tracks across the country were those left by horse-drawn wagons. The nation needed a coast-to-coast railroad.
They started in the east, laying down the rails, and out in California they were blazing out a trail. Toward the center they did strive, no one knew when they would arrive, building the Transcontinental Railroad. They cleared the way and blasted through the mountainside and built big trestle bridges stretching over valleys wide. And it's a fact they laid more than 3,000 miles of track to build the Transcontinental Railroad. It took 6 years and in the spring of 1869, in Promontory, Utah, they connected the two lines. And across this growing nation, folks joined in the celebration of